All right. A couple of weeks ago, we started a new series, a mini-series that will cover Bezat Hashem several weeks of the summer, about a verse that is found in the Navi, what Hashem asks of us, of all things, Ki masot mishpat ba'avat chesed v'atzne'a alechet im Elohecha, to do that which is just, to pursue kindness, and to be modest in the ways of Hashem. So I basically decided to divide up these weeks into three, to speak a little bit about mishpat. What does it mean to do just? What does it mean to do mishpat? What does the word mishpat mean? That it is so important that the Navi says, this is what I ask of you, even though there are 613 commandments. As I explained last time, the various Nevi'im attempted to summarize the mitzvot into the basics. And one of the reasons they did that was to help that particular generation in whatever area they were weak to be able to fulfill all the mitzvot. So by concentrating or by focusing on that which they were weak in, that would enable them eventually to fulfill all the mitzvot, to fulfill all the mitzvot that are written in Torah. So the three basic ones involve doing that which is right, that which is just. That's a very important area of mitzvot ben adam lechavero, commandments that have to do between one Jew and another. Nothing to do with ben adam lamakom. There are a lot of important mitzvot, of course, between us and Hashem in our relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, like Shabbat, right, like Tefillin and the holidays. But here the Navi stresses that these are very important, and they all three, especially the first two, Mishpat and Ahavat Chesed, the pursuit of kindness, have to do with relationships amongst human beings. And we talked about the importance of the world surviving as a world, for civilization to be able to continue to exist, for people to be able to get along and have a normal, decent life, there needs to be law and order. Law and order is part of Mishpat, but there also needs to be tzedakah v'chesed. There needs to be a certain amount of fairness plus the pursuit of kindness, which means it's not only for you to be happy, it should be your business, it should matter to you that others are happy as well. And the third part, which we'll talk about towards the end, has to do with tzniut, modesty. It's not only about the dress code. Modesty has to do with doing things for the sake of heaven and not to take credit for them, not to do things so people should respect you for them, but to do things for the real reasons. That's called atzne'a lechet emelokecha. These three areas are very important, especially now as we're beginning with Chodesh Elul, the month of Elul, where we prepare ourselves to do proper teshuvah. Teshuvah, even though it means to repent, it really means a bedek habayit. It is house cleaning. It is checking ourselves, examining our lives to see what it is that we need to repair, what it is that we need to change, because Bezat Hashem comes along Rosh Hashanah, and we will have our new year commitments, Bezat Hashem. We will be taking upon ourselves commitments seriously that will hopefully affect our lives, change our lives for the better. So these three areas, Mishpat, Chesed, and Tzniut, are extremely important. Mishpat has many details, many, many halachot, and that's what I want to cover a little bit tonight, the second part of what we did a couple of weeks ago. We began with an introduction and a generalization of how Mishpat is so important for the world, how it is important for human beings to have Mishpat. And now I'm actually going to go into detail and share with you the various halachot that are not known to everybody. And what does it mean to be just, to do things properly? Mishpat has a lot to do with money. Money, unfortunately, has been throughout the ages worshipped as the golden calf, as an idol. The rabbis are aware of us, and they tell us very, very clearly, be very careful with it, because when it comes to money, the majority of the world has some sort of weakness with it. And even though not everybody is an armed robber, gezel doesn't have to be armed robbery. Gezel, which means to steal or to rob, could be done in other ways that you would never imagine. It's called stealing. It's taking that which is not yours. And therefore, the rabbis tell us, you have to be extra careful when it comes to somebody else's money, because the human brain is a very powerful attorney and can easily justify taking that which is not yours. So what we need to first understand before we begin to talk about the many examples in the areas of life that perhaps we don't always have the right judgment and we may make mistakes, we need to understand why is it that money is such a problem that people are not as concerned about how they affect other people's lives. In other words, are they hurting somebody? Are they taking that which is not theirs? Why aren't people concerned if, as a result of their actions, somebody else is going to get hurt? After all, if you take something from somebody else, you're gaining and that person is losing. Right? So it's not just a ta'ava here. It's not just a desire to have something. It's that too. But it's some sort of lack of sensitivity onto the other person. You are actually, indirectly or directly, hurting someone. So where does it all come from that a person should be mezalzel, should actually be careless and look down and not be as respectful of other people's money? In order to be able to be strong in mishpat, in this area, it requires a tremendous amount of work. It's not just halachot, as we will soon see. It's also a certain amount of discipline. Kesef, the rabbis tell us, comes from the word kosef. Kosef means to desire, to want very, very much. More than any other desire in the world, people have a tremendous desire for money. It's the greatest yetzerah, it's the most powerful yetzerah, that people have an interest in money more than anything else. People enjoy sleeping, people enjoy eating, people enjoy many things in life. But money is the biggest kesifa, it's the biggest ta'ava that people have. And that is why the Torah even warns us, and warns the rabbis, that when it comes to money, be careful. It comes to bribery, money, and bribery can even blind the eyes of the wise. It doesn't say of human beings, of ordinary individuals, of the wise, of chachamim, of sages. Money, bribery. You put $1 million on the table, how many people can refuse that kind of amount of money? Yeah. We don't even have to talk about $1 million. How about $100,000? How about $10,000? It's a lot of money for somebody who doesn't have that coming in so easily. That is why you have a lot of corrupt politicians, police, and other people in high positions who for money are willing to do that which is wrong. So we see from various sources, the money corrupts, and because the human brain can easily justify it, it's coming to me, it's magiali, right? For all sorts of reasons, if one really wants to do the right thing, he really cannot use his own judgment. In order to be very objective, you have to ask others. Give me your opinion, is this correct or not? Otherwise, you can easily make a mistake. So one of the reasons that people make this mistake is because hem kosfim. Kosfim means that they desire this, they very, very much want to have it. The second reason is, of course, choser yediyah, lack of knowledge. People are unaware that something is asur. That's number two. Number three is forgetfulness, and I'm going to give examples of that. People forget. They took something, they forgot they took it. Number four, there's the ashpata chevra, there's the bad influence of society in which we live in, where we see other people do certain things and we think it's acceptable. That's also a problem. And number five is that the nisayon. Nisayon means that sometimes people are tested. As the rabbis tell us, ha-pirtza kora laganav. What attracts the thief? Why does the thief choose this home to break into and not another home? Because he sees a pirtza. He sees an opening. He sees that this one has no bars. This one has no lights. This one has no cameras, no alarm. He sees some weakness there, And that's what draws him to break into that house. Hapirtza kora laganav. Right? You leave us, you have a small hole, you're gonna have mice go in there. It's whose fault is it? It's the hole. The mice otherwise wouldn't get in there. And of course the cheese too. You know? So that calls or that attracts the robber, and of course the mice are thieves too. And therefore, when there are such situations where people are being challenged, are being tested, yesh nisayon, it is tempting. It is simply tempting. And even though they usually don't do something, it is tempting. Let's say somebody tells you, you know what? If you take this, you're going overseas, take this suitcase for me. And I'll give you $25,000 just to take a suitcase. What's in the suitcase? Drugs. Hey. And if you, of course, don't examine what you're taking, you're going to be in jail for many, many years. But it's tempting. He's giving you $25,000, so you may not even ask questions. You actually feel perhaps embarrassed to let him down. Maybe he's a good friend. How could you not? Right? So that's the nisayon. There are situations that people run into, even though they never did anything wrong, because of the pitui. Because of the bait, as it's called in English, it's very tempting. So very, very briefly, what did we say last time? That in order to avoid falling into this trap, one of the first things a person has to discipline himself with and work very, very hard to acquire is tzaddik bemunato yichyeh. As the Navi said, if we summarize all the mitzvot, not into 11 or 6, but one mitzvah, which will be the mitzvah that will keep us out of trouble, that will be the biggest help for us in being able to fulfill all the Torah, if we are able to choose one, it's emunah. If one would have the proper emunah in bitachon Hashem, the proper trust and reliance in Hashem, that Hashem decides exactly how much money you're going to make, nobody will be able to take away a penny from what is coming to you. Those people who cheat, who take that which belongs to others, whatever way they do it, they're lacking emunah and bitachon b'Hashem. In order for a person, therefore, to protect himself from falling into the trap of the yetzer hara when it comes to money, he has to develop a very strong emunah and bitachon b'Hashem. And you should know something. Not too many people are strong in this area. They believe in God creating the world. Yes, they have that basic, that's called basic emunah. But sheyishna hashgacha pratit, that he oversees, that he decides my parnasah, every penny, all my expenses and my income, everything, not everybody believes in that. They say they do, but they don't. Actions speak louder than words, you know, and people do not conduct themselves in their life with that kind of bitachon. And there are many areas of life where one can see for himself how much of a bitachon he has. As I gave you the example of a broker signing on Shabbat, this is a great deal. If he signs, the deal is his, and he can make 6% on a $25 million house. If he doesn't sign the deal, they will give it to Coldwell bankers. What's the catch? He has to come sign on Shabbat. They tell him Friday, if you come tonight, you have the deal, but you have to sign tonight, otherwise we give it to somebody else. What is he going to say? He's going to make a lot of money. He's going to sell this house. He's going to have exclusive rights to sell this house in Bel Air. 6%. And he hasn't made an income for the last 6 months. Tzadik bemunato yichyeh. If he has emunah, what is he going to say? If Hashem wanted to give me this money, he would give it to me in a kosher way, not for me to be mechalel Shabbat. What does somebody do who's a chochmolog, as we say in Hebrew, who's trying to find all kinds of heterim and tricks? I once learned in yeshiva that I could sign with my left hand. You know, with a shinui, with a change. Maybe I can sign with my feet. That's not called signing, yeah? This is a lack of emunah. This guy has a kippah, maybe even has a beard. He puts on tefillin of Rashi and Rabbeinu Tam, two sets. Goes to Vatikin. Of course, it's glat, 100%. Everything is fine, but when it comes to money, he fails. A lot of people fail when it comes to money. So these are the ideas that we covered last week. But we're trying to understand how to avoid it. That's what we're trying to do tonight. How to avoid this pitfall? So Tzadik Bemunato Yechiyeh tells us very, very clearly one of the most powerful ways to get out of trouble when it comes to money issues. Develop, discipline yourself with a very strong emunah in bitachon b'Hashem, that He controls the world, that He determines every penny you're going to make. Nobody's going to take what is yours. What's coming to you is nobody's going to take, no matter what they do in the world. And if they did take it, you're going to get it back from somewhere else. Somehow, even if they took it. You know, sometimes you go to court and you lose. And you might say, well, maybe it was meant for me to lose. Not necessarily. It wasn't necessarily meant for you to lose. It was meant for you to lose in this court, perhaps, because there were false witnesses. What can we do? Hashem is not going to stop the false witnesses. He's going to let them get away with it. But it's not coming to you. Eventually, you get it from somebody else. Right? Your husband, your wife will make the money somehow, somewhere else. So even if you lost in court, and it wasn't meant for you to lose it, you're going to get it back. The Torah tells us, "Kamishpat lelokim hu." You do have corrupt judges. You do have false witnesses. That's the world we live in. And Hashem says, don't worry. Hamishpat lelokim hu. The ultimate mishpat, not initially, but the ultimate. In the end, maybe 10 years down the road even, you'll get it back. Then why did I have to go through this painful experience of spending money and attorneys and all that? You didn't have to. You really didn't have to. You caused it for yourself. You could have settled very easily. You could have done it right. You didn't have to go to court. You could have gone into a din Torah. You could have settled it through friends. You chose to fight it. So you spent in the end, you spent all the money that you were going to make, you spent on attorney fees. But don't worry. If it's coming to you, you're going to get it back. If it's not coming to you, then it was meant for you to lose it. So that requires a tremendous amount of bitachon in Hashem. Tremendous. To be able to understand what happens around us. If a person is fair, he will never lose. But when it comes to money, it's very difficult to be fair. That's the problem. It's coming to me. I have all the rights to this. And I can explain. Why don't you ask a whole bunch of people who are outsiders if that's the correct thing, if what you're thinking is right or not? Only strong emunah can therefore protect a person from gezel, from taking that which is not his. Number two, you have to learn the halachot. Person who does not learn the halachot does not know what is gezel. He thinks this is okay for me to take. This is a big insurance company. They're goyim, chas v'shalom. He thinks from goyim it's okay, even though it's asur. If you don't learn the halachot, you will never know. Importance of learning halachot is also, let's say a person is doing teshuvah for all the money that he took that was not right, that was not his. How is he going to correct it now? Do you know that according to the real halacha, if you build your house from stolen material, you have to remove all the 2x4s that were stolen. You have to take apart the house. The Chachamim, of course, said, if we demand that of the individual, he'll never do teshuvah. So we will allow him to pay money instead of actually removing the original 2x4s, the original nails that he stole. You don't have to return the original item, because otherwise it would be too difficult for a person to do proper teshuvah. So let's allow him to give the equivalent. So therefore, learning halachot is important because we have to know how to do teshuvah. A person wants to do teshuvah. How does he correct? He's been stealing for the past 25 years. He doesn't even know. All the people, they're gone. Some of them died. Does he go to the heirs, to the children? Goes to asks mehila in the graves if he knows who those people are. There's many halachot. How to do teshuvah for all these years, for the gezel, for all that money that you took from people that are no longer alive. How do you repair all the gezel, all the money that you've taken, and all the damage that you've done? How do you do it? By learning halachot. So halachot is important to be able to show one the way of doing complete teshuvah. Of course, halachot are important because they remind us of what is right and what is wrong. So you shouldn't repeat your mistakes. So all of this basically reminds us that learning is extremely important. Otherwise, one can easily make mistakes. Okay, now that we understand that it's important to learn, we understand the root of the problem of kesev, how do we go about it? Where do we start from? How does one discipline himself properly if he has this weakness? The first area of discipline is called lo tachmod. In the Aseret HaDibrot, in the Ten Commandments, you find that towards the end. And the commentaries tell us, why is this one at the very end? What does it represent? Because it is through lo tachmod, do not covet, do not desire that which is not yours, that one can come to transgress kol averot sheba Torah. He will covet, the guy doesn't give it to him, he's going to steal it from him. Then he's going to swear falsely. Then he's going to murder him. Then he's going to leave his religion and go worship other. One leads to another just from coveting, the commentaries tell us. From coveting, one can come to transgress all the mitzvot in the Torah. Coveting. Lo tachmod. Now, what's the difference between lo tachmod and lo titave? Not to desire. What's covet? Covet means you go over to Shimon, I like your car. I want you to sell it to me. Shimon says, I don't want to sell it to you. I bought it for myself. No, I really want to have it. I'll pay you for it. If you insist on taking, even if you're paying, you insist and you try to convince somebody to give you that which he bought for himself, that's called lo tachmod. People cannot control desires. The Torah doesn't say lo titaveh, exactly. It says lo tachmod, do not act upon it. Do not go and do something as a result of your chemda. If you just have an interest, but of course you're not going to act upon it, that's not exactly asur, even though it's also not right. So lo tachmod is something that has to be worked upon. How do we work upon lo tachmod, that one should not covet? So the commentaries tell us, one of the commentaries says, look at it as though you're a farmer, a simple man. Would you ever have an interest or a dream or the imagination that you could ever marry the daughter of the king, the princess? It's impossible. He doesn't want you. You can never imagine. It's just not, it's not shayach. Then why are you even thinking about it? Why are you covering it for? So the Ibn Ezra, who gives this mashal, explains the same is true with anything. Anything that is not yours, just think about it in this way. It's not meant for me to have it. Then why should I even think about it? Had Hashem wanted me to have it, he would have given it to me. If I don't have it, that means because he feels it's better for me not to have it. It doesn't belong to me. Person who always has chemda is full of hatred and jealousy. A man of chemda, in other words, he's always coveting, he's always full of hatred and jealousy because he will dislike the person who he wants to take something from. He will be jealous of him. He will eat himself up alive. He will always be bothered as long as he doesn't have what he so much desires. And even though these individuals who are balei chemda do good things occasionally, those good things are only to impress people. They're not good for the sake of goodness. This man cannot be 100% good. Chemda is the opposite of good. Chemda is selfishness. You want something for yourself. A person who's jealous, who wants things for himself, he thinks about himself and his family, he cannot properly do good unto others. If he does, it's just because he has to or because he wants to have a good name. It's not good for the sake of goodness. Because he's a jealous man. He hates, he dislikes. People who hate others, who dislike others, who talk bad about others, there's something bad in them. Misha pogea bashini, pogea batsmon. In other words, mum shebachavercha, you know, don't point out those defects in other people because you're basically pointing to the defects that you yourself have. That's the way it works. It's a person who's not happy, who is bitter, right? He will basically stoop to this kind of a level of blaming others for his problems, of criticizing others for his problems, not necessarily for what they did. He claims that they did, that they are like that, but it's not necessarily so. It is a problem that is stemming from his bitterness, from his depression, from his ungratefulness, all these terrible midot, all these terrible characteristics that exist in people who are negative. A person who is good, a person who is tov, doesn't hate. No matter what the person did to you, even if he's an evil person, may Hashem forgive him. I have nothing against him. I'm very unhappy at his actions, of course. But there's no hatred. There's no lashon hara. There's no bitterness. person who has no bitachon b'Hashem, who is bitter himself, who is a negative person, obviously you're going to have all this package of all kinds of troubles. They're going to be jealous. They're going to be hateful. They're going to talk negative about others. That shows that they're incomplete. They're unrefined. There's something wrong with them. Chaval. For a person during his life not to try to begin to work on himself. You know, but people, of course, don't want to do that. It takes a lot of work. And that is why we have the kind of world we have. Well, there's a lot of people who are always upset, who are always negative, who are always taking that which is not theirs because they don't work on themselves. They don't learn. So the Navi has to come back and tell us, listen, you know, it's not enough that you put on tefillin, that you pray to Hashem. He won't even listen to your prayers. If you can't get along with others, if you hate others, if you're revengeful, if you take that which is not yours, you think you're doing Hashem a favor? That you're buying Ptichata Echal for Ne'ila and you're paying $10,000 for it? Who are you trying to impress? When the ways of one are corrupt, he has so many accusing angels against him that all the other deeds really go nowhere. How do we uproot this chemda, this desire, this very powerful desire to have that which is not yours? So I gave you the mashal of the commentary of the Eben Ezra's to think that this is almost impossible for me to have. Obviously Hashem doesn't want me to have it, but that's very basic. That's very, very basic. The more general attitude that one has to have in order to conquer chemda is emunah. Not to have any worries and concerns. What's going to happen tomorrow? People who are jealous, people who want to have, are insecure. They feel, I need this, I want this, I need it for my kids, I need to marry off my kids, so I want to have this. These are all insecurities. A person who has true emunah, lo do'eg lemachar, he doesn't have any worries for tomorrow. A person who does worry, that means his emunah is not strong enough. Very, very simple. So we're going back to this idea of working on emunah, and number two, working on midata istapkut. Midata istapkut means to be content with whatever you have. Hashem wanted me to have this, not more. I'm very happy. Baruch Hashem, that this is, some people have less than what I have. Some people are not as fortunate. So this is a way for a person to psychologically, mentally, and emotionally begin to work on himself, to discipline himself, to get away from this terrible midah of wanting to have everything, to want to have more than others. And it's all, again, insecurities, and insecurities come from a lack of emunah. The next area that one has to confront and do battle with is, of course, the area of gezel. We spoke about chemda, which is in the heart. Some people act upon it. They want to have this, they want to have that. But now we need to talk about gezel. And we said earlier that the reason why people sometimes steal or take that which is not theirs is not because necessarily they want it. It could also be because they're unaware that what they're doing is wrong. So that is why it's important to learn the halachot. So let's go through a few examples of all these little things that occur in our lives that we're sometimes not aware of that can be a problem of gezel. Example number one. You have the secretary working at the office, and the boss leaves for the day. He leaves early. And she says, oh, great. Picks up the phone and makes a long-distance call to her friend or sister and speaks for an hour and a half. Now, what did she do? What did she do? What was wrong with what she did now? Anybody know? What does the secretary do? She took the time that she's being paid for to work and used it to talk to her sister. Plus, the second problem is she made a long distance call for personal matters. That's also gezel. Two kinds of gezel in one phone call. A lot of people do that. Yeah, it's okay. You know, if you make a phone call occasionally to your husband, to your kids, hi, what time you're coming home? I think most employers allow for that. That's normal. You know, okay. But to take a lot of time and long distance calls? No, I don't think anybody allows that. But some people justify it. I've been working for him for 20 years. It's coming to me. I mean, after all, he didn't give me a promotion that I really deserve. You know, all kinds of silly things to justify doing something which is obviously wrong. Next one. You have a heavy suitcase. You're in the street. And you don't have a place to put it down. And you see a nice looking car. You know, 2010. I don't know if they're out yet. Right? And you put it down on this car. It's not yours. Don't you realize that you may be scratching? You know, a new car, a scratch is significant, right? A 1980 car, I don't think the guy cares as much. How do you do that? How do you put something down on somebody else's car, especially a new car, when you know that that may bring a scratch to the car? Mizalzelim. This is called in Hebrew zilzul, bemamon hazulat, being reckless and being careless. And basically not being concerned about other people's possessions. The next one is one of my favorite ones because unfortunately it's so common it almost happens every day. Somebody starts looking around. Oh, by the way, do you have a pen? Did it ever happen to you? Somebody asked you for a pen? Only if you have one. If you don't carry one, they won't ask you. Yeah. And they take it to sign something, and they never give it back. Now, if it's a cheap pen, big deal, right? But even then, it's gezel. And they continue using it later on. And imagine if it's a very expensive pen. I once thought about it. Maybe I should always carry two pens. The nicer pen, keep inside, and the cheap pen for those who need it, who will never give it back. Yeah, because it happens. But this is forgetfulness. But forgetfulness doesn't mean that it's okay. Forgetfulness means you better be careful. Since you are forgetful, be careful not to forget. I don't know if I told you, but there are people that I recall in yeshiva when I was in Israel, used to come over and ask me for an asimon. In Israel, in the olden days, the way you made a phone call was with a token. Not with money, you put in a token inside. So they, boys came over, do you have one of those? So I started giving them out. They didn't give it back. And I'm not going to go bother asking them each one. You know, if they don't do it on their own, that means they're irresponsible and I'm not going to lend them the next time. I saw one. As soon as I gave him the asimon, he took out a pad of paper and wrote down, I borrowed an asimon from him. I said, I can lend him again in the future. I can trust him. Because he took and he wrote down because he doesn't want to forget. Now, some people don't have to write down. They will not forget. I know some people are so careful when they take money from others as a loan that they can't go to sleep until they've given back the money that day, as soon as possible. They can't tolerate the fact that they have somebody else's money. It's the other extreme of people who are careless and don't care. And what's the big deal? It's only a quarter. It is a big deal because if you take a quarter, you eventually can take more than a quarter. It's irresponsible. It's carelessness. Then we have the example of Shoel Shelo Medat. Shoel Shelo Medat is also called Gezer. Rabbis tell us a person who borrows an item without asking for permission is a form of Gezer. Maybe he will not give you permission to use it. There's a question in halacha whether you come to shul and you forgot your tefillin, your talit, can you use somebody else's? So the halacha says many people are not makpid on their tefillin and talit, as long as you put it back in the same spot, as long as you fold it back exactly right. You have to know the mentality of the people. But there are things that people are makpid. You can't just take somebody else's object without asking him permission first. If it's a sefer and you use it once in a while, that's fine. People like the fact that somebody's going to be doing a mitzvah with your sefer. But it depends what it is. You cannot assume, unless you ask, that the person will say, okay, go ahead and borrow it. It depends what it is. Or using a lost item, something that was lost that belongs to a Jew, or a friend that gave you, I'm going on vacation, can you wash this for me? You cannot use an avedah or a pikadon, something that was given to you without the permission. That's called sholeach yad. Shlichut yad, in other words, you use your hand to use something that is not yours without permission. Then there are several examples of what we call in Hebrew nitzul, that unfortunately is also very common. That's taking advantage. I'll give you an example of a story that happened in Israel. You know, Israel has strikes all the time, especially in the hospitals. You know, the doctors go on strike. And there was somebody who was very sick that needed to go to see some other doctor as a result of the strike. At the end of the consultation, he asks the doctor for a receipt. He's paying him. But on the receipt, he said, don't put any name on it. He says, why shouldn't I put a name on it? He says, you see, I'm not a member of Kupat Cholim, but my friend is. And if he takes this receipt, he will be able to get a reimbursement. Your friend is going to get a reimbursement, but he's not the one that went to see the doctor. Yeah, but that's okay. Chava ala kesef, he says. If he can get the money anyway, why not give him the receipt? They're going to reimburse him, but he's not the one that came for the consultation. It's not coming to him. But people take advantage, menatzlim. They take advantage, you know, any opportunity that they have. Oh, just why don't you just go get welfare? But you're not entitled to it. If you're not entitled to it, then that's called stealing from the government. No, but the government gives it anyway. No, they don't give it anyway. They give it if you really need it. It's the same idea. Another form of nitzul, somebody gets into a car accident. Okay, he's insured, Baruch Hashem. How much damage is to the car? $2,000. But he has a $1,000 deductible, right? You know about deductibles? He goes to the collision guy shop, the body shop. Can you put $3,000 on the paper for the insurance company instead of two? Like this, I don't lose my deductible, you know. At least everything will be covered. That's called stealing. It's very simple. It's black and white. It's not true. It's $2,000 and not three. So if you tell them to raise it just so that you can, you know, get all the money that you want, that's called stealing. And people assume that it's okay. The insurance companies, they don't mind. They have millions of dollars anyway. They don't check it out. It's called gezel. It's called sheker too. Lying. Another example of nitzul. You go to your boss with a piece of paper. Can you please fill out this piece of paper that I'm not really making as much money as we both know I'm making, that I'm making a lot less. In this way, my child can get a scholarship. You know, in order for his child to get a scholarship, he has to show that he's earning less. That's also sheker gezel. What are you talking about? Why should somebody do something like that for you? But people do that. Now, what happens when the father and the mother do these kind of things? The children will also follow. And all of a sudden, in a number of years, you have a whole mafia, a family. The children and the grandchildren. Chabura shel ganavim. Because the father or the grandfather started stealing from the government, started cheating on his taxes, started, you know, doing things that are not correct, and the wife saw it, and the kids saw it, and they said, it's acceptable, that's the way we do business here. Maybe Nigeria, but not here. Yeah, you can't do business like that. That's called stealing. Here's another great example. You come to a store that sells fruits and vegetables in Fairfax, or wherever you buy your stuff, Pico, whatever. And you see some beautiful blackberries and strawberries and cherries, you know, summer fruits, tasty. And you start, and you don't intend to buy. You don't intend to buy. You're just taking, you know, one or two. You're not eating a whole, you know, handful. You're not allowed to do that unless you intend to actually buy it. You're tasting it because you want to know if this is what you want to buy. Otherwise, the seller does not agree, does not accept that this should be done. But people do it. Oh, it's you know, it's okay. It's not okay unless you intend to buy. You intend to buy, you have a right to taste, you know, here and there. They don't mind if you take, depends what it is. You know, what are you going to take? You're going to take a whole mango too and taste it? You know, how about eating a whole watermelon? You know, you don't trust the guy to knock on that. You know, you can't tell by knocking. Slice it up and let me taste it. And then you say, Ma salama, see you later. You know, you can't do that. That's gezel. That's a form of taking that which is not yours. Here's another one. Can I borrow your bus card? Why do you need my bus card? Because your bus card says that you get a discount, you're over 55. And this guy is not 55 yet, he's only 50. Right? If he would be 40, he wouldn't pass for it. But you know. Or you're 20 and you take the child student's card because students get a discount. Whichever it is, you're using a card that is not for your age just to get a discount. Come on, what are you doing? That's called gezel. And people assume it's okay. These things happen on a regular basis and people are not careful with it. And this is gezel. This is regular gezel. Gezel doesn't have to be highway robbery. Okay, let's see a few more examples of gezel that you may never have thought that it's called gezel. One is called gezel sheina. Gezel sheina, you're up late, your music is blasting, and the neighbor next door to you can't fall asleep. You're robbing him of his sleep. That's called gezel sheina. And do you know that sometimes if people get up in the middle of the night after they were interrupted in their sleep, they have a hard time falling asleep, going back to sleep? This guy may be now up for the rest of the night. A lot of our tzaddikim and chachamim were so careful. They came home sometimes so late, they didn't want to wake up their parents. They didn't want to wake up the rabbi or whatever. They slept outside. They slept in the Bet Midrash because they didn't want to knock on the door. They were so careful with Gezel Sheina. They know that these people need a sleep. They need to wake up the next morning, go to work. Hasagat gvul is another area. If you're into building, two neighbors, you're building a fence, you're building a room addition, and you take that which is not yours of the lot. That's called encroaching in English, to encroach into somebody else's property. Hasagat, that's one form of hasagat gvul. Hasagat gvul means going beyond your boundary, means several things, but one of them means building beyond your boundaries. There was an individual, I think it was in the 80s or in the early 90s, I forget when it was, a very religious man in Bnei Brak who had a near-death experience. Near-death experience, you remember what that is? He somewhat was dead, went up, and came back, right? And while he was up there, he had a mini judgment. And he told him, how did you take books from the shul, you borrowed books from the shul, you never gave him back. That's gezel. This is a religious guy. He was completely shocked because he totally forgot about it. How come when you built that wall, you didn't talk to your neighbor about it? You know you were blocking his light and his fresh air by putting up a wall right in front of his window? Even though you have certain rights, you have to perhaps talk it over with your neighbor so you can come to some agreement, maybe make some modifications so you can have a pleasant relationship with your neighbor. Why didn't you do that? Why didn't you consult just Magi Ali, it's mine, it's my property, I'm going to do whatever you want. Why didn't you think about that? Why didn't you concern yourself with your neighbor? This they told him upstairs. When he came down, he lived for another 3 months. He tried to correct everything that he did wrong. Baruch Hashem, I think he succeeded to return the books that were taken, to ask forgiveness from those that he may have hurt. They're very makpid upstairs. They're very, very strict with every little thing, every little detail that we may have forgotten about. Here's another example. You go to a Persian wedding. Why did I say Persian wedding? Because there's a lot of food. And that's all you do is you eat. That's all you do. What did you do wrong? Anybody know? You went to a Persian wedding and you ate a lot of good food. And then you went home. That's called gezel. Gezel? Yeah. Because the only reason the couple, put out so much food for you is because they invited you to be mesameh chatan vekala. You didn't dance and make the chatan and kala happy. They don't want to pay a meal for you to come and eat. Go eat somewhere else. They don't need you there to eat. They need you there to participate in the dancing, in making the Hatan Vekala happy. So rabbis tell us, Kol ha'olech le'seudat hatanim, whoever goes to a wedding, ve'lo mesameh hatan vekala, gozel. He's stealing from them. He's stealing from them the mana, the meal that they prepared, thinking, assuming, desiring that you're going to share with them in the simcha and be happy for them and wish them and perhaps bring a little gift and perhaps and dance. And you didn't do that. That's gezel. And it can come as a big surprise to people. Well, that's all they do. Oh, great. I'm going to have a good meal tonight. Right? Good caterer, good food. That's not the purpose of the wedding. One has to be very careful not to buy merchandise, stolen merchandise, because in this way he's supporting the thief. He's allowing him, encouraging him to continue to steal. That also, if you know that this is stolen merchandise, you have to be careful. And here's another example of sometimes people are not careful enough with paying when they need to pay someone for their services. Shatchan. You know what a shatchan is? Matchmaker. Puts together people. Sometimes they work many, many hours to try to bring people together. There is a custom in the Jewish community to give them something. Some people have a set price. This is what I want if I'm successful. Some people, especially if it's a friend, if he's not a professional shatchan, we give him some money, we give him a gift, as long as he's happy. You're not cheap, you give him something nice. There was once a couple who, for many years already, were not able to have children. So the man or the father went, I think it was to the Chazonish. I think it was the Chazonish and asked, Kvod Arav, we don't know what's wrong. We went to all the doctors, we tried everything, and, you know, the woman is not able to conceive. So the Chazon Ish, Baruch Hashem, you know, Yadruach HaKodesh, he asked him, tell me, did you ever pay the Shatchan? No, I never paid the Shatchan. V'gam lo magia lo. It's not even coming to him. He didn't work hard enough. What do you mean, not magia lo? Did he bring this together? Was it his idea? Yes. Go pay him. I advise you to go pay him. He paid him, and what do you think happened after a couple of weeks? She conceived. You have to be very, very careful. People who cause pain unto others, people who take from others, people who don't pay others for their services, it brings a tremendous kitrug against them. And you never know how this kitrug will affect you. It can affect you in marriages, it can affect you in children, it can affect you in parnasa, kitrugim, accusations. We don't want to have accusations. So you have to be careful. Now let's talk briefly about payment. When we're talking about payment, there's different kinds of payment. There's the payment of services, of course, that are rendered. If you have a contractor, if you have a worker working for you, the Torah has various mitzvot just about that. Pay him on time. You know what paying on time means? That day. He finished that day and he's a daily worker, you pay him that day. If he's a weekly worker and you pay him by the week, you pay him at the end of the week, as long as you have the money. If you wait a day, you're already transgressing. You're already transgressing one of the transgressions of the Torah. Taking your time. He can wait. No, he can't. He maybe needs the money right away. Maybe he's embarrassed to tell you. So pushing off payment when you can pay, you do have the money, is a form of stealing. Let's say you tell him the check is in the mail. The check is never in the mail. You just tell him, come back next week. And it's all just to postpone, to push him off. Yeah. You're lying to him. You're stealing from him. You're hurting him. Yeah, and people do that. People do that all the time. The worst, of course, of all of this is people who borrow money and don't want to give it. They take the money and they spend it on vacation. It's one thing you needed the money and you just don't have it right away. Okay, but you spend it on luxuries? You borrowed money just, you know, for things that are not that important and now you don't want to give it back? What's the problem of these people? Why don't people want to give it back? Again, the Yetzirah justifies it in all sorts of ways. Eh, he doesn't need the money now. I don't really have it now. I need it for other things. He has enough money anyway. He owns a lot of properties. He won't feel the pinch. Anyway, he owes it to me. He owes it to me too because I once did a favor to him. There's all kinds of ways. It's all gezel. There's no justification for it. one has to actually begin this discipline not only with himself, but with his kids. When you see children behaving themselves in certain ways, you have to let them know that this is wrong. Can't allow them to get used to lying, to cheating, to taking that which is not theirs. That's where you begin. You begin when they're still children. Another example is going back to work, is where you have a photocopy machine and you come to the photocopy machine and start photocopying all your personal papers. That's also, you're using the machine of the work for your own things. You have to ask permission. You can't assume that it's okay. Unfortunately, in Israel, this is very common. Here, not so much. In New York, maybe, but in Israel, it happens too much. People cut in line. You know what the cut in line is? There's a line, tor, and they cut. That's called gezel. Gezel? Yeah, you know why? Because you robbed him from the time. He was closed. Now, because you went in there before him, that means you've robbed him of an additional 10, 15 minutes that he may have to wait. That's called gezel too. People don't think about it, that cut in line before someone else. You've robbed him from extra time that he now has to wait. The rabbis, in realizing that there's so many details involved in Ilchot Gezel, in taking money, in misusing people's money, attempted, of course, their best to be able to repair whatever they did wrong. Some of this is, like I said before, very difficult to do. But even if it was done when you were a young child, if it's possible to repair, you have to repair it. And the example that I like to give is the Chafetz Chaim. Chafetz Chaim was a child once upon a time too. And he, with a group of little kids, once took apples from this lady who sold apples without any money, without paying her. They ran away. They thought it was cute. When he became a little bit older and realized how terrible it was what he did, he looked all over the place for this woman. He finally found her, came over to her, put in the money that he owed her from who knows how many years ago, and ran away. In other words, he didn't take anything. You know, just put the money that he owed her from the past. Rabbis tried their best to correct anything from the past, anything that they were able to correct, so they shouldn't have this stain on them. There was another big rabbi who once approached the Ari. The Ari HaKadosh was able to see on your forehead what sins you committed. The forehead has the Aleph bit. According to the Kabbalah, if you know how to see it, you could see all the Aleph bit, all the letters of the Aleph bit. He says, Rabbi, do you see anything wrong in my life? He says, yeah, I see the gimel upside down. The gimel upside down? Yeah, that means that you stole. I stole? This is a big rabbi. He says, yeah, you may have done something that you don't realize. This rabbi had a big factory. So, you know, maybe he didn't pay someone, but he asked his employees, is there anybody here I didn't pay? Do I owe any money? Everybody says, no. We're very happy with you. We thank you. Nevertheless, I'm willing to pay. Nobody came forward, so he decided to take a whole bowl of money. All right, here's all this money. Take if it's coming to you. One woman went to the bowl and took out a few coins. When he went back to Dari, Dari says, Baruch Hashem, the gimel is back up. Your sin is erased. And let me tell you the story behind this woman. This woman once worked overtime, and you never paid her for it. Or she did something extra. And it was coming to her. And because of that, they were very makpid on you. You're a great man. And of course, it's a form of gezel. But Baruch Hashem, since it was never your intent to intentionally do that, they allowed you, of course, to be able to repair it by me letting you know. And it was min hashamayim, person who's really innocent, they will allow him somehow to be able to repair it. Share with you a story that happened in Yerushalayim about 10 years ago, give or take. There was a terrible suicide attack or bomb on one of the buses. Unfortunately, whoever remembers those days, there were many, many bombs. And in one of those buses that was bombed, a very, very special man, a Jew, a religious Jew, died, was killed. And I don't remember if it was after the Shiva or sometime later on, he appeared in a dream to one of the rabbis, a Talmid Chacham in Yerushalayim, do me a favor. I owe this grocer man who has a grocery store, some money that I never paid him. And you know, I'd like to finish up paying him. It's bothering me that I still have debts in this world. And this rabbi went looking for this man. The man had already closed his shop. He was no longer in business. So, but he finally found him, and he says, "Tell me, does anybody owe you money?" He says, "Yeah, even though I closed my business, I still have the pinkas. I still have the booklet of where I know." And it turns out that this man who had been killed owed him a few dollars. In Israel especially, I don't know how much here in America, in Israel it is normal for people to ask the owner of the store, "Tichtov et ze, tirshom et ze la pinkas. Can you please write it down?" And they buy on credit. And if you don't, you know, pay up, you know, you owe. And this man had a little debt. So the rabbi took care of this small little debt. What's interesting about this dream, however, is they don't give permission to just anybody in Olam HaEmet to come down in a dream to appear and to ask people for help. He must have had some zechut, some merit, that allowed him to appear in a dream to be able to clean up whatever he had left to clean up. Okay, let's talk a few more examples of gezel. One is called gnevat dat. Gnevat dat is when you steal the mind. What does it mean to steal the mind? You mislead people. You give the wrong impression. Let's say you come to somebody into his store. Whatever it is. How much is this? How much is that? How much is this? The guy is getting excited. This guy is going to want to buy a few things. And you never intended to buy anything. After taking his half an hour time asking him prices, you leave. That's called gnevat dat. You're misleading him. You're leading him on, is better said in English. To lead somebody on, to misrepresent something, it's a form of gneva. Gneva, stealing dat. Misleading him. Another better example of gnevat dat is this. Let's say you have a guest in your home and you really have had enough of him. You had enough of him. He's been 3 hours in your home and you're uncomfortable telling him to go. Finally, he gets up to go. And you tell him, "Don't go so fast. Sit. Shev ktsat, ot ktsat. Ma ata memaher lalecha? Why are you going so quickly?" You know, people sometimes out of courtesy, that's how they talk like that. "No, you don't have, there's nothing to hurry." But that's not true. You're so happy he's leaving. Yeah. That's called gnevat dat. Don't lead him on that you're so nice that you really want him there when you don't want him there. You're lying. You're giving him the wrong impression too.
He might stay longer.
Yeah. You go over to somebody. "I have to have you over for dinner. I have to." You insist on him and you know 100% he will never come to eat dinner for you. For whatever reason, he can't make it. But you just insist on him because you want to lead him on that you're so, such a nice man that you want to have him. But if you know he's going to refuse, then don't do it. You're allowed to ask people to please come over for dinner once, twice, three times. But if you insist knowing that he's not coming and you're only doing it to impress on him, that's gnevat dat. As far as people who are in business, the areas that people need to be more careful on, you cannot sell something as is. I sell you the car, as is, and you know that this guy has 1 mile to go with this transmission. 1 mile from now, after he drives away from your house, the transmission will be kaput. I'm selling it to him as is. No, and as is not acceptable in the Torah, if you know. If you can tell him, "Listen, check it out with your mechanic. You know, it's a used car. It has some problems. It's not in the best condition." That's different. You don't have to be specific. The plugs, the this, and that. No, check it out. But if you know something is wrong and you're misleading him, that's a gezel. Or somebody who takes a house. Let's say a house completely infested with termites. The wood is rotting, but he starts painting it beautifully to cover up all the... That's gezel. You're misleading the guy. You know, by painting that which is rotten and old with new fresh paint. Or grocery stores. They take the beautiful strawberries and put them on the top and the rotten ones in the bottom. You're allowed to mix. You're definitely allowed to mix if the person buying it can see. Okay, this is mixed. Some are good and some are bad. Some cherries are squished. Some are old. That's fine if you can see them. But if the guy can't see them, and you put it all the way down in the top, you put the big ones and the red ones, that's called gnevat dat. That's gezel. It's a form of gezel. Then there's honaat goy, cheating a goy. Just because it's a goy doesn't mean it's mutar, as we said before. As it's brought down in Tanat Veliyahu, it's brought down a story where somebody was so happy and proud of himself that he misled a goy in a big business deal. In the end, he lost all his money. In the end, he lost it. There's no beracha. Makes no difference that he's a goy. Sometimes it could be a big chilul Hashem too, if it happens with a goy. Chafetz Chaim was known to be very, very careful with all these areas. And there are many, many stories about him. I want to share with you one story of how careful he was with paying on time. Somehow, he was in a rush to go somewhere in the winter, and his coat, his me'il, got stuck. It got stuck, and as a result of getting stuck, it tore. So he needed this coat. It was cold winter, so they ran to the tailor. The tailor on the spot took care of it. And because he was in a rush, he went with the wagon driver to the train station. And as he's already a couple miles away from the city, he says, "Oh, you got to take me back. Take you back? We've made all this way. The train is about to leave, and now you want to go back?" He says, "I have to pay the tailor today." He says, "Rabbi, don't worry. You're already by the train. The train's about to leave. I'll pay the tailor." "No, no, no. I want to do the mitzvah." You see examples, there are many, many such examples of tzaddikim who were extra careful to pay on time, to pay what is coming to the person. They were very, very concerned about any hashash, any problem of gezel. Another area that we have to be careful is the area of being mezikim, not to hurt. How do you hurt people? A person who smokes in a room, today they know that secondhand smoke is also hurtful. A person, therefore, is mazik when he smokes and other people are getting the smoke, if they are getting. I mean, if it's a big area, maybe not. He's a mazik. You put out your garbage in the street where people can fall and step on it. You're doing some construction. You have to be very careful in what you do close to your property if people are going by. That's all called mazik. Mazik is a form of it's not exactly gezel, but it is hurting another individual in a way that you, of course, may not have intended to, but it happens. Then there are people who are malshinim, who are informers, telling people this guy didn't pay his taxes, this guy is laundering money, this guy is doing some other illegal activity. That is mazik. That is a very, very dangerous thing to do. The only time you're allowed to tell on someone is if he's a danger to society. If a man, an individual, is a danger to society, he drives drunk. He's a drunk. He always drives drunk. You got to tell the police. You got to get him off the streets. That's a mitzvah to tell on him. That's different. There are examples of people where you're allowed to, if they are a danger to society. But otherwise, a Jew has no right to tell on another Jew to the authorities. It's a big avon. Another area that one has to be careful is the area called Ani Ameapech Becharara. Ani Ameapech Becharara means a poor man sees a cookie. He's about to grab it. Comes along somebody, snatches it before he's able to grab it. You see the man is about to take it. Why are you snatching it? Even though you got there first, before he was able to lay his hands, if he was about to lay his hands on it, you can't take it. You know where this happens? It happens in real estate. Somebody's about to buy a property. He hasn't signed the deal yet. Obviously, once it's signed, it's his. But he's buying it. Comes along, somebody tells the seller, "I'll give you $10,000 more. Sell it to me." This happens. This happens. People are not aware that this is asur. If the bid is open to everybody and everybody bids different things, okay. But if one is already about to close the deal and you come at the last minute, that's aniyah me'apech becharara. It's asur. It's gezel. It's taking that which is not yours. He was already close to closing the deal. Have to be careful from competition, even though there may be room for many, many people to do the same business, but sometimes it could be damaging. Chafetz Chaim used to close his shop early in the day in order to allow everybody in the neighborhood to do business. He didn't want all the customers coming to him. You have to be sensitive in this area. Then we have the last area we have is sheker. Sheker is a big problem. Rabbis tell us, v'dover emet bilvavo. Train yourself to speak the truth in your heart. What is speaking the truth in your heart mean? In your heart? The famous story with Rav Safra. The Gemara tells us Rav Safra was busy saying Kriyat Shema. And he's in the store. Comes along, somebody wants to buy something from him. Safra doesn't answer. Can't talk in Kriyat Shema. So the guy thinks that Rav Safra doesn't accept his price. Okay, I'll raise it. I'll give you more money for it. He doesn't answer. He was raising it. Finally, Rav Safra finishes the tefillah and goes over to him and says, I'll take your original price. Even though you were raising it, thinking that I was not accepting, that's what I intended originally to sell it to you. I'm not going to take advantage of you since you didn't know that my lack of answering you was just because of the tefillah. He was dover emet bilvavo, in his heart. Whatever he intended, that's what he did. Another story of Rav Safra is very similar. This Rav Safra was in business. And one time he wanted to sell an object for 100 coins. And the guy said, I'm only giving you 80. No, I'm not taking less than 100. Okay, so the guy left. A couple days later, Rav Safra needed money badly. He says, you know what, if I see that guy again, I'm going to give it to him for 80. It turns out that guy, who didn't want to buy it for 100, decided, you know what, I'm going back to Rabbi Safra. I'll give him the 100, since I really needed to. He comes to Rabbi Safra, I'm willing to give you 100. No, I'll take 80 now. I've already changed my mind to accept. Even though he was ready to give 100, he was willing to go down. He didn't take advantage of that. He sold it to him for whatever he had made his mind up to. That's called dover emet bilvavo. I just want to finish with a story that I heard from my grandfather. My grandfather came home one day. Zalman, can you do me a favor and bring me Tzefania? Tzefania? Yeah, over there. Tzefania from the Treyasar. Yeah. Over there at the very end. Yeah. You may see it there. My grandfather had lent somebody some money. And every time he saw him, he saw this man at the kotel. No, says, where is the money? I don't have. Time after time after time after time, I don't have. So my grandfather comes home. My father then was young. And he asks the children in the home, so what do you say? This man says he claims he doesn't have. Should I believe him? So the kid said, yeah, the man says he doesn't have. As enlo. Says, "Enda varkaze." He's lying. If a man really wants to pay back a loan, he could give me a dollar a day. When a person does not give a dollar, it's not that he doesn't have, he doesn't want to. There are people out there that owe money, they don't want to pay it back. If a man can't, doesn't have it, needs it for something else desperately, okay. But there are people who don't want to. That's already rasha. That's already a wicked person. And that's a problem. And that is why Tzefania, let me read you what Tzefania says, one of the prophets. No, this is fine. Yeah. I think this should be okay. Let me just read you one pasuk here that basically sums up everything. In talking about Am Yisrael, the Jewish nation, how we have to be careful to sanctify Hashem's name. Perigimel. Oh, I found it. She'erit Israel, the remnants of the Jewish nation. Lo yasu avla, they will not do any avel of that are corrupt. Lo yidabru chazav, they will not lie. Velo yimatze b'fihem lashon tarmit, they will never be heard saying something which is tricky, which is cheating. At that time, when Am Yisrael, when the remnants of the Jews will actually follow through in complying with this, in actually being an example for the rest of the world of being honest and not cheating and saying the truth and never lying, never doing anything avil, anything wicked, anything corrupt, they will have no reason to fear. They will prosper. They will be in peace. If we're having all this trouble, as we've been having throughout the diaspora, it's because something obviously has not been right. Something has been obviously wrong. And we've spoken a lot about this in the lecture of baseless hatred, which even though it may not involve money, but it leads to money. Because if people do not respect each other, people do not like each other, they can easily come to take from them, to abuse them, to cheat from them, to lie to them. When people are respectful of each other, if we all look at each other as brothers and sisters, we're all from the same parents, how could we hurt one another? How could we? How could you even think about that? What enters our mind? It's all selfishness. It's all sinat chinam. It comes down to baseless hatred. Or it comes down to a zilzul, a lack of concern and empathy for others. What is this world all about? It's about sharing. You're not the only one in this world. I want to remind all of you, it pays to lose $1 million. It pays to lose a lot of money, but to be in peace with as many human beings as you can. Peace. Peace with your family. Peace with your brothers and sisters. Peace with your friends. Peace with Am Yisrael is more important than any money in the world. If it costs you money to make peace, pay for it and make peace. What's money? You don't take it with you. It's shtuyot. It's so stupid. But people think that this is everything. Money, 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 money. Money has become a god. And that is why people today are going bankrupt. People are losing their money. Hashem is teaching a very, very powerful lesson to humanity. You've made this money into a god. It's going to burst. This bubble is going to burst. I'm going to show you that this money is going to be worthless. This paper is going to be paper, real paper. And that's what's happening. A little bit of what is happening today, Hashem is letting us know we got to wake up. We got to clean up our act. We have to be just with each other. We have to remove the sinat chinam. And one of the ways to do it is by being kind, to do the opposite, to be kind, to pursue kindness. And Bezat Hashem, the pursuit of kindness, Bezat Hashem, will cover next week. Thank you.